to Cambridge House Live. I'm Bridget Anderson, and joining me is Dr. Michael Berry. He publishes Morning Notes. He's also a former professor, your money manager, and you are an expert in geopolitical matters. Looking at what's happening right now around the world, what would you say is the most pressing geopolitical matter?
Well, Bridget, that's a great question. I think right now, dealing with deleveraging in the developed world, obviously problems in Europe, the banking system there is tottering, it's sort of on the verge of failure, and Greece, these issues are sort of coming home. They will have an impact for all of us. So there won't be any escaping what happens in Europe, and I think right now that's probably the most pressing issue. It does look like in the United States we're beginning to see a little bit of bottoming out of the problems, but we still have a lot of debt to deal with, and that has to be dealt with.
There's also changing, or possibly changing, political dynamic in the U.S. as well.
Yes.
So how big a factor does that play?
That will be a very large factor. And we've seen in the Republican debates, I think there have been 8 or 9 of them so far, shifts, and you really see some very concerned voters. Just the fact that Congressman Ron Paul can score second or third in these primaries is amazing. So people are concerned about the way the country is going, and it's showing up in some of the voting. Whether or not the current president can lose, I don't know. He's got a big war chest. So it's going to be a very, very interesting time going forward.
It's certainly an interesting time when you look what's happening right now with the Republican Party as well. I mean, I think a couple of weeks ago, some people might have said that it was Mitt Romney's to lose. And given what has happened with Newt Gingrich, things perhaps are not a done deal yet.
Yeah, I think Newt's come back big. People liked what he had to say in South Carolina the other night. Thought he was probably treated unfairly by the liberal press in the U.S. So all bets are off now. There's no sure winner on the Republican side yet.
Now, you have been a guest lecturer at the Federal Reserve, and you've also testified in Congress when it comes to natural resources. Talking about natural resources, let's shift to that. Where do you see right now is the biggest growth?
Well, first of all, I think in the U.S. we don't have a natural resource policy. So it's a very good thing that we live next to Canada, because Canada does, and just this issue of the XL Keystone pipeline being turned down, this gives Canada the opportunities to diversify their oil sales. But really, in the U.S., the biggest issue right now is how do we develop a critical metals ability to bring forward things like rare earth elements and manganese and so on, and how can we do that over the next few years?
And do you think that's a more pressing issue than oil and gas?
Yes, it's at least as pressing as oil and gas. Obviously, a country's productivity and well-being is directly related to the cost of energy. And in the U.S., we're going with energy modalities now, like photovoltaics and wind and so on, geothermal, that aren't economic. And that's a wrong way to go. So we're headed down the wrong roads in terms of the current administration. But in general, we need to have a natural resource policy which blends in the environmental concerns with the ability to be able to produce in our own country.
I think there was a lot of hopes pinned on natural gas, but really over the last year or two, there has been a lot of criticism about the fracking process and the kind of environmental impact. Where do you think the future lies for natural gas?
I think natural gas in the U.S. has a very, very bright future. Just from a demand perspective, natural gas can be made into diesel. I mean, there are all kinds of value chains that surround natural gas. Natural gas is more of a state-oriented thing, so we don't have to worry about the State Department getting involved and turning things down. The environmentalists are concerned, but if you looked at the Eagle Ford Shale in Texas or the Bakken Shale in North Dakota, Bakken is now producing 500,000 barrels. So I think it's very positive for the country that we are going to be able to diversify our oil and gas resources.
A lot of hopes pinned on natural gas in British Columbia as well. A lot of developmental potential.
Yes, without doubt. There's no doubt that Canada is a feeder system for the U.S. It's an extraordinarily important neighbor. I wrote a morning note the other day in which I estimated that within a few years, Canada could provide 50% of U.S. domestic imports of oil and gas. That will depend largely, of course, upon some of the pipeline issues that are now. But I do believe that actually the XL pipeline will be developed over time. And so I think Canada will be providing a significant portion of U.S. imports.
If the Keystone Pipeline does go ahead, but it is delayed, does that give Canada the chance to move ahead on Gateway Pipeline?
It does, and Canada should move ahead on the Gateway Pipeline.
Do you think the Prime Minister and the federal government is moving in that direction?
I do. Having coming up here on the plane, I was reading the National Post, and which is one of my favorite newspapers, and also the Globe and Mail. And I think he's made it pretty clear. I think the Prime Minister has made it fairly clear to President Obama in a direct conversation that we're going to diversify. And so I think that's an important thing for Canadian sovereignty. I mean, this is a country with 35 million people and all kinds of resources. So I think it's very important that Canada does move ahead and diversify its supply.
But Canada still has some serious challenges when it comes to the oil sands.
The
oil sands, extracting oil from the oil sands.
Yeah, I've spent a lot of time in the oil sands. The oil sands will double production in the next few years. There's nothing, I don't think the environmentalists, the companies up there, the Suncors and the Syncrudes and the companies, are taking environmentalism seriously. They're putting new technologies in place. You're going to see a lot more production come out of the oil sands. It's going to happen one way or the other.
I want to focus now on the junior mining sector. You are unveiling a new software program here at Cambridge House that will have a direct impact on investors when they're looking and trying to evaluate some of these junior miners. Tell me about the program.
Well, about 10 years ago, I was a money manager in New York, and I was working with a microcap company. And microcaps are they're small. They're the smallest companies. They're the junior miners that are here. And so I developed a 10-factor model. What are the 10 most important factors? Just to give you an example, we always like to look at management first. That's one of the factors. What is their track record? Can they carry this project forward? Will they be able to create wealth for shareholders? Are they buyers of the stock and so on? So I built a 10-factor model, and we just over the last year put this on the computer with a very powerful mathematical package. And we think it's the only system in existence today that actually focuses on discovery companies. So it's a discovery-oriented system.
So it looks forward rather than looking back.
It does. It has risk embedded into it. You know, when I was a professor at the University of Virginia, we talked about beta being a risk measure and standard deviation, and none of that makes any sense for a lot of companies. These juniors mostly don't have revenue or profits or cash flows. And so we tend to look forward, and we tend to stay away from quantitative, hard estimates. And so we're very forward looking in our opportunity. We have a database created now. A lot of these companies, a lot of biotech companies, a lot of high tech companies are in the database as well.
Does this model look at particular companies, or can you do a more macro approach? Can you look at regions or things like that through this?
You can, actually. And so, for example, we'll have one database of just rare earth elements. And what are the rare earths? One on copper and so on, that sort of thing. It's called the Discovery Investing Scoreboard. It allows us to rank the companies from top to bottom based upon how people think they see them. And a lot of people are imprecise about, don't really understand these companies. So we allow people to be imprecise, and then we rank the companies based upon that imprecision.
So this is being unveiled here, and it's ready to go?
It's ready to go, yeah. Actually, our unveiling is today, and in a few minutes I'm going to go present it in the main hall.
Great. Well, I really look forward to hearing more about it. Thanks very much for joining me, Dr.
Thanks, Bridget. I enjoyed this.